Hello, dear students. I hope you are having a great time at home. My name is Dr. Wasim Mushtaq, and I am your biology teacher. Since you are in class 7th, and if you have a look at the syllabus given in your book, there's the very first chapter in your book is the basic biology. Chapter first is basic biology, and today in this lecture we are going to deal with the different topics and subtopics of the chapter basic biology. Okay. So let's start with it. You see that all living organisms, whether plants, animals, birds, insects, whatever living organisms you find on the surface of the earth, all living organisms are made up of cells. All living organisms are made up of cells. So we can say that the cell is the structural, is the basic structural and functional unit of life. Why? Because all living organisms are made up of cells. So remember this. Okay. So before going into detail about the basic structure of a cell, like what is the composition of the cell, what are the different organs, we call them as cell organelles of the cell, we'll talk about that. But first we should know about that how we can know about the existence of the cell. How, I mean, cell was already present there, but how do we discover it? Okay, so let's talk about the discovery of the cell, cell discovery. You know that the cell, it is microscopic. Means we cannot see cell, we cannot see individual cells without naked eyes. Like we human beings are made up of millions and billions of cells. But we cannot see the cells without naked eyes. So we need microscopes to see those cells. So it first started with the, before we discovered the cell, we came to know about the invention of the microscopes, because to see the cell we need the microscopes. And how did the microscopes come into existence? There was a person called named Anton van Leeuwenhoek. There was a person named Anton van Leeuwenhoek. He was a Dutch scientist. He was the first person to invent a simple microscope. A simple microscope, okay, and through this microscope he found out that there are so many small organisms present in a droplet of the water, okay, but he did not name them. Okay, then there came the second person. His name was Robert Hooke. He invented a compound microscope. Know the difference? Anton van Leeuwenhoek invented a simple microscope, but Robert Hooke invented a compound microscope. This compound microscope was made up of two lenses. Okay, this compound microscope invented by the Robert Hooke was made up of two lenses. And through this, with the help of this microscope, he experimented with the cork cells. Cork is the outer layer of the tree trunk. The outer layer you see is made up of the cork cells. So he observed these cork cells under the microscope, and what he found that there are small compartments like the monastery in cell. Okay, he found the small compartments there, and there he gave name to those small compartments as a cell. Understand? So what Robert Hooke found in those cork cambium, it was actually the dead cells. We'll study this in the higher classes, that the outer layer of the tree trunk, the cork cambium, is made up of dead cells. So what Robert Hooke observed was actually the dead cells, though he gave the name cell to those monastery or those compartments. So this is where from where the word cell came into existence. So remember that Robert Hooke was the first person to give the name cell, or the first person to discover the cell. So this is how cells were discovered. Okay, now let's talk about the cell theory, modern cell theory. Actually, these were three people, and all of them were the Germans. Okay, there was a German scientist named Schelling. In 1838, he said that all plant cells are made up of cells. All plant cells are made up of cells. Then there was another German scientist named Schön. In year 1839, he said that all animal cells are made up of cells. Understand? So Sheldon and Sean, they, we can say, collectively said that all plants and animals are made up of cells. Then 50 years later, a third person comes to the party. His name was Virchow. Rudolf Karl Virchow was his exact name. 50 years later, he said that all cells arise from pre-existing cells. Okay, so remember, Sheldon and Sean, they said that all plants and animals are made up of cells, and Virchow said that all cells arise from pre-existing cells. Okay, so collectively, they gave the modern cell theory. So modern cell theory has three main postulates. Number first, all living organisms are made up of cells. All living organisms are made up of cells. Number second, cell is the basic structural and functional unit of life. And number third, all cells arise from pre-existing cells, which means that the cells, they divide and they give birth to the new cells. Okay, if you see the cell division in the amoeba, there's one amoeba cell, it divides into two amoeba cells, and those two divide into further four amoeba cells. So this is how they keep on increasing their number. Understand? So we can similarly in human beings, our cells, they continuously divide. Okay, so we can say that all cells arise from pre-existing cells. Actually, Rudolf Virchow used a term, a German phrase, cellulus omnicellula. Cellula omnis cellula, which means that cells arise from pre-existing cells. So these are the three main postulates of the modern cell theory, that all living organisms are made up of cells. Cell is the basic structural and functional unit of life. And number third, all cells arise from pre-existing cells. So this is a modern cell theory. Now there is diversity in cells. Diversity in cells means that cells vary in number, shape, and size in different organisms, in different species. Like we human beings, we are made up of one kind of cells, plants are made up of another kind of cells. So we can say that these cells vary in the diversity, okay? And some animals are unicellular, some are multicellular. Unicellular organisms like amoeba, paramecium, euglena, okay? My other bacteria and viruses, they are unicellular. They are made up of only one cells. One cell is capable of performing all the functions in their life. Okay, but we human beings, and other large birds and mammals, we are multicellular organisms. It means our body is made up of millions and billions of cells, which is not so in the case of the bacteria and the viruses, because they are unicellular organisms. They are made up of only one cell, but we are made up of many, many millions and billions of cells. Okay. And cells also vary in the size. The usual size, the normal size, the average size of a cell is 3 microns to 5 microns. 3 microns to 5 microns. What is micron? Micron is equal to the 1,000th of a millimeter. Means if you divide, means 1 centimeter has 10 millimeters. And if you divide that 1 millimeter into 1,000 times, if you divide 1 millimeter into 1,000 times, that 1,000th part is the 1 micron. So now you can guess the size of the cell. It varies from 3 microns to the 5 microns. However, the smallest cells in human beings is the red blood cells. Point to be noted. Smallest cell in human beings is the red blood cells, RBCs we call them, or erythrocytes we call them. Okay, and but you see this, the egg of a hen. Egg of a hen is about 3 centimeters long. Okay, that's also a cell. And the largest cell is the egg of the ostrich, which is about 15 centimeters long, which is about 9 to 15 centimeters long. So this is how I was telling you that the cells vary in size and shape, and they also vary in number. I give you the example of the unicellular and the multicellular organisms. Cells also vary in shape. Means some cells are spherical, some may be oval. For example, some may be thread-like, like our neuron cell. Our neuron cell is thread-like. And you know, the neuron cell of an elephant is about 3 meters long. So I was telling you about the diversity in cells. Now let's talk about the basic structure of a cell. Usually we study cell into two separate categories, plant cell and animal cell. There are some differences which I will tell you when we go through the details. If we have a look at the structure of a cell, you find that it has an outer membrane. That outer membrane is called as the cell membrane. It acts as a protective layer or protective barrier between the cell and the external environment. Okay, we call this as cell membrane or plasma membrane. But there is one more layer. There is one more layer called the cell wall. But the cell wall is only present in the plants. It is not present in the animals. Cell wall is absent in animals. Cell wall is only present in plants. And the cell wall is made up of a material we call that as cellulose. Cell wall of plant cell is made up of cellulose, and this cell wall is absent in animals. Okay, now let's talk about the function of the plasma membrane and the cell wall. Cell wall is completely permeable, means it allows any substance to pass through it. But the cell membrane or the plasma membrane is semi-permeable or selectively permeable, means it allows only certain substances to pass through it. It does not allow every substance to pass through it. So cell wall is permeable and cell membrane is semi-permeable. And if you have a look at the center of the cell, you find there is a spherical structure there. We call this as nucleus. We call this as nucleus. So nucleus is present in the center, almost present in the center of a cell, and it has thread-like structures in it, and we call that as chromatin. Chromatin. And those chromatin during the nuclear division or during the cell division form the chromosomes. And the role of these chromosomes is to pass on the genetic information from the parents to the offsprings. So we can say that the nucleus acts as the control of the cell. And nucleus is responsible for passing on the genetic information from the parents to the offsprings. Nucleus is a double membrane cell organelle. We call them as cell organelles. This is a nucleus, mitochondria, chloroplasts, etc. We call them as cell organelles. Cell organelles means organs of the cell. Like we have organs of the body, head, forehead, eye, ear, toes, lungs, skin, etc. Similarly, cell also has its organs. We call them as cell organelles, like mitochondria, chloroplast, Golgi bodies, endoplasmic reticulum, etc. Okay, so nucleus has a double membrane. And there are also nuclear pores between these double membranes. Okay, so nucleus has a role in the, passing on the genetic information from the parents to the offsprings. So we studied cell membrane, we studied cell wall, we studied nucleus. Now let's talk about the cytoplasm. Everything inside the plasma membrane is called as the cytoplasm. You see this, there's a gelatinous fluid present inside the plasma membrane. We call this as the cytoplasm. Okay, now coming to the other section, there's mitochondria. Mitochondria is also a double membrane cell organelle present inside the plant cell as well as the animal cell. Mitochondria is common to plant cell and the animal cell. And mitochondria is also is called as the powerhouse of the cell. Why? Because it's actually the mitochondria which during respiration is responsible for the generation of the ATP, adenosine triphosphate, which we also call as the energy currency of the cell. Always remember that ATP is the energy currency of the cell and mitochondria is called as the powerhouse of the cell. Okay, why? Because it generates ATP. Mitochondria is a double membrane cell organelle. Okay, and this inner membrane is folded into Christi. We call them as Christi, C-R-I-S-T-A-E. Okay, so the inner membrane is folded into Christi and outer membrane is regular. All right, so mitochondria is also done. Okay, now here let's talk about the plastids. Plastids are only present in the plant cells. Plastids are absent in the animal cells. Okay, there are three kinds of plastids. Plastids are also double membrane, okay, and it has a thylakoid membrane. Okay, so plastids basically are of three types: chloroplasts, chromoplasts, and leucoplasts. You only have heard the name chloroplasts so far. Okay, plastids, they are called as the kitchen of the cell because they are responsible for synthesizing food during the process of photosynthesis, where carbon dioxide is taken from the atmosphere, water from the soil, and in the presence of the sunlight and the chlorophyll, food is synthesized. in the form of glucose, that is C6H12O6. So that's why we call plastids as the kitchen of the cell. All right, I was telling you plastids are of three types. First is the chloroplasts. Chloroplasts are green in color because they contain a pigment called chlorophyll. And it's actually the chloroplasts that are responsible for carrying out the process of photosynthesis. Number second is the chromoplasts. Chromoplasts are all the colored, you find the colored flowers, the colored fruit, different colors you find in the fruits. It is because of the chromoplasts, because it's actually the chromoplast which is imparting color to the different, to the leaves, flowers, or the fruits, except the green color. Green color comes from the chloroplast. Any other color comes because of the chromoplasts. Okay, and number third is the leucoplasts. Leucoplasts are found in the underground, usually in the underground parts of the plant, like the underground stem or the roots, and they are responsible for storing food. In the vesicles, we call them as amyloplasts. All right. So plastids are present only in the plant cell, and they are absent in the animal cell, because animals do not do the process of photosynthesis. So why would they require the plastids at the first place? Okay. Next is the ribosomes. There are two kinds of ribosomes. First is the ribosomes that are attached to the endoplasmic reticulum, and the other kind of ribosomes that are freely floating. These are called as the free ribosomes, and these are called as the attached ribosomes. And the function of the ribosomes is to synthesize proteins for the cell. So we call them as the protein machinery of the cell. Okay, so ribosomes is common to both plants and animal cells. So ribosome is also done. One more thing is there is the endoplasmic reticulum. Endoplasmic reticulum, it is attached to the a part of the endoplasmic reticulum, and the outer one of the membranes of the endoplasmic reticulum is attached to the outer membrane of the nuclear membrane, is attached to the outer membrane of the nuclear membrane. Okay, so this endoplasmic reticulum acts as a skeleton for the cell. It provides the shape and support to the cell. All right. Then next is the vacuoles. Vacuoles are common to both plants and animal cells. Vacuoles, they may act as reservoirs to store food, and they also maintain the tonicity or the water potential of the cell. And last but not the least is the lysosomes. Lysosomes act as the suicidal bags. They are single membrane cell organelles which contain enzymes. You see here, enzymes are present here. So if any foreign object comes inside the cell, these lysosomes engulf that and destroy it with the help of the enzymes. And the last topic in this chapter is the cell division. In cell division, we studied how cells divide. There are basically two kinds of cell division. First is the mitosis, and number second is the meiosis. Actually, there are two kinds of cells, somatic cells and gametic cells. The gametic cells, there are two kinds of gametes. Eggs present in the females and sperms present in the males. Except these two kinds of cells, all the cells present in human body are called as the somatic cells. The somatic cells undergo mitosis cell division, and gametic cells undergo meiotic cell divisions. What is mitosis and meiosis? You will obviously study this in the higher classes. This is not at your level, but I'm telling you that there are two kinds of cell division. One is mitosis, found in the somatic cells. One is meiosis, found in the gametic cells. What is the purpose of cell division? Now, first is to increase the number. For example, in unicellular organisms like amoeba paramecium, a single amoebatic cell, when it divides into two, means their number increases from one to two. And when these two amoeba cells further divide, it becomes four. So it is how their progeny is proceeding. Okay. Number second is the repairment. Our cells, they have a definite lifespan. For example, our red blood cells, they have 3 to 4 months. WBCs, they have a few weeks. Platelets, they are 5 to 7 days. So what happens if all these cells will die? Okay, we will die. But what happens in reality, in actual, what happens? The cells are continuously dividing. we are shedding off our skin continuously. But those skin cells which are shed off, they are repaired by the, they are replaced by the new cells. Okay, so cell division is necessary for first growth, number second repairment, and number second to increase the number. So this is all about today's video lecture. Hope you understood it. And if you still have any confusion or any doubt, you can just text me on the WhatsApp group. Thank you for watching me.